all have questions. We all need answers. It is on this program that we get our answers from the Bible. It's time to Ask the Preacher with Reverend Carl Gallups of Hickory Hammock Baptist Church in Milton, Florida. Welcome to another edition of Ask the Preacher. I'm your host, Mike Bates. With me in the studio, as he is every week, is the pastor of Hickory Hammock Baptist Church in Milton, Florida, Reverend Carl Gallups. Welcome, Carl.
Mike, thank you so much. It's always good to be here with you.
In addition to being the pastor of Hickory Hammock Baptist Church, Carl Gallups is a best-selling author.
Thank you.
His first book was The Magic Man in the Sky, Effectively Defending the Christian Faith, which, by the way, was an outstanding book.
Thank you.
And his second book is titled The Rabbi Who Found Messiah, The Story of Yitzhak Kaddori and His Prophecies of the End Time.
Yeah.
So, Carl, on today's edition of Ask the Preacher, let me just ask this question, very open-ended. Who is this rabbi that found Messiah, this Yitzhak Kaddori fellow?
Yeah, well, that's a fair question. And, you know, Christians in the West may not have been so familiar with him until now. But Yitzhak Kaddori was 108 years old when he died in January of 2006. Now, what makes him so special is the fact that when he died, 300,000 people came to his funeral, Mike. They had to close the streets of Jerusalem down for the better part of 2 days. Ben-Gurion International Airport was cram-packed with airliners flying in from all over Europe. Major media around the world ran at least snippets of parts of his funeral. I mean, the president of Israel gave the eulogy at this man's funeral. This guy was not some little obscure rabbi tucked away in the depths and bowels of Jerusalem. He was the most venerated rabbi in Israel's modern history. He lived in Israel before it was even Israel again. He lived in the land of Palestine in the early 1900s. He was there when Israel was reborn. He was there when World War I took place. He was there when World War II took place. He was there at the rise of Nazism and the Holocaust and the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood. He helped Ariel Sharon get into office. Prior to that, he helped Benjamin Netanyahu get into office and was in the media continually with speaking prophecies about Israel and Jerusalem and the coming Messiah. I mean, this guy was venerated. He was celebrated. He was famous. All of those are synonyms, of course. That's who he was. Millions of people around the world, Jews particularly, followed this man's life and ministry. So that's who he is.
Well, and in this book, you speak of the prophecy that he made. And I want to just say that you did a very good job of it.
Thank you.
I have been one who throughout my life have never understood prophecy.
I mean,
Isaiah, Daniel, and forget Revelation.
That's Ezekiel,
the most confusing
Revelation,
book of all.
Zechariah,
I don't understand any of it. But to your credit, you not only take prophecy and acknowledge that you're not necessarily 100% right on it, because a lot of people who say that this is what prophecy is are very adamant.
Right.
It's absolutely this way. And yet some other preacher is saying, no, it's absolutely this way. Well, they can't both be right. To your credit, you acknowledge that this is an interpretation of it, and there could be different opinions on this.
Right.
And you've been blessed, and I've told you this before, and I don't mean to praise you too much, but it's the truth.
Please do. I'll give you 30 minutes to stop.
You have been blessed with the ability of taking very complex topics and explaining them in a very understandable way without being condescending.
Oh, well, thank you. That's very nice of you to say.
Not everybody can do that. You do a very good job at that, and on the radio show and in your writings. So I just want you to know that.
Thank you.
You did a very good job in this book putting the prophecy into a very understandable format, at least for somebody like me.
Yeah, well, okay. I appreciate that.
So let's talk about the prophecy.
Yeah, it's shocking.
Rabbi Yitzhak Kaddori makes this shocking prophecy. What's the prophecy?
Yeah.
And what is so incredibly shocking about it in the modern day?
Yeah, well, thank you. It is. And the story that I'm getting ready to tell you, folks, is true. I mean, it's all documented in my book. I'm not making this stuff up. And it is shocking. It's profound. It rocked and shocked the Orthodox Jewish world. It shocked the Christian world. It shocked the Muslim world. And let me explain it like this. In the fall of 2005, now remember I told you he died in January 2006, but in the fall of 2005, Yitzhak Kaddori was still alive and well, 108 years old, but in good health, as far as anyone knew, and he shocked the world, the people that were listening at least, by making two startling statements. Startling statement number one, he said, I've had a vision of Messiah, I've met Messiah, I know who Messiah is, and I know his name, I know his real name, I know who the real Messiah is, and I'm going to put his name in a note, and the note is to be opened 1 year after I'm dead. Well, now, you know, he could have lived another 10 years. He didn't know when he was going to die, but that's what he said in the fall of 2005. That was startling thing number one, he said. Startling thing number two, he said, and it has also been revealed to me, and obviously he meant through God in this revelation, that Messiah, this Messiah, would not come until Ariel Sharon had died. Well, at the time he spoke those two startling statements, Ariel Sharon was still alive. He was the 11th prime minister of Israel. As a matter of fact, in July and August of that same year, he had just gone through the Gaza Land for Peace giveaway deals, etc., and was quite controversial around the world, although recent polls in Israel then showed that he was going to win again with a landslide victory, but he never got a chance to run. When he made those prophecies, they were both alive and well, but within a handful of weeks, by January the 4th, Ariel Sharon suffered a massive stroke and was in a coma. Now, that coma would last 8 years and 7 days. But, of course, at the time, you know, who would have dreamed of that? I mean, most people, you know, a coma a month or two, maybe a year or two at the most, but 8 years and mm-hmm. 7 days exactly, dying on a Sabbath day, which is connected to Kaduri, because when Kaduri died, he died on a Sabbath day, a Saturday. So, January the 4th, 2006, Sharon goes into this coma. January the 28th, 2006, same month, same year, just a few weeks apart, Rabbi Kaduri dies. Now, that was January 2006. January 2007, a year later, the note is opened. It's put on Kaduri.net, Kaduri's own website. Somebody within his organization puts the note up there. It's written in a Kabbalistic, mystical, coded kind of format, but it's there. Israel Today, out of Jerusalem, Israel, they ran a story on the note. News First Class, News One, out of Israel, ran a story on the note. And the note eventually was decoded within some days or weeks after it was put on the website. And I'm just going to get to the crux of the matter. When it was decoded, it was revealed that the name that Kaduri left for the Messiah was not some Jewish Hebrew name that you would think of. It was not some venerated leader of Israel, you know, that he named. But rather, he said the real Messiah's name is, in Hebrew, Yehoshua, which is the long version of Yeshua, which translates to English, we would say, Jesus. Jesus is the Messiah. Well, I mean, that's anathema to the Orthodox Jews. And here's the Billy Graham of all Jews making this, you know, this statement of anathema, this heresy statement. And so the Jews immediately were just offended and dumbfounded. How could their Billy Graham, so to speak, how could he say this? And so the Kaduri people within his organization and people very close to him immediately went into cover-up and denial mode. My book outlines all of this. They began saying, well, the note was a hoax. It was a fake. It was a forgery. It was a trick. It was pulled off the website. The Israeli media basically shut the story down, whereas before, everything this rabbi ever said, they printed it. But when this came out and it was revealed what he had really said, they quit talking about it. Major media around the world wouldn't report on it. To this day, they're not reporting on it. They just shut it down because it was too unthinkable. It was too profound. It was too shocking. So that's the story in a nutshell, that this famous rabbi, 300,000 people at his funeral, the president of Israel speaks, gives the eulogy. This famous rabbi proclaims that the name of Messiah is Jesus, and that he will come, he will appear, he will present himself, he will be here after Ariel Sharon dies. 8 years, 7 days after he goes into a coma, Sharon dies on January 11th, 2014. And the world waits, and prophecy watchers are watching. Prophecy buffs around the world are digging deeper now as they realize the profundity of this prophecy.
Why do you suppose that Rabbi Yitzhak Kaduri waited a year? When he wrote down this prophecy, he said, a year after my death, mm-hmm. you may reveal mm-hmm. this. Mm-hmm. Why wait? Well, wouldn't it seem logical to just announce it while you're alive so you can defend it?
Right. Well, probably a couple of reasons. First of all, we have evidence, my book reports, and the movie that was produced about my book. There's a documentary movie on my book by WND Films and George Escobar, the producer. But both of them report and catalog that prior to his death, he was teaching in his yeshiva, which is, as you know, the Hebrew word for a rabbinical training school, to his students. And these aren't 20-year-old kids. We're talking 40, 50, 60-year-old men training to be rabbis. He was revealing in his rabbinical training school that, as a matter of fact, the name of Messiah was Yeshua. We have testimony from some of these students who gave their lives to Jesus Christ as Lord because of Kaduri's teachings. So he, as a matter of fact, Mike, was revealing it before the note. But watch, if this really was a revelation from God, and Kaduri thought that it was, and I'm not Kaduri's spokesperson, I'm not standing on a soapbox, I'm not his PR agent, I'm not proclaiming that he's a 100% accurate prophet and that he really had this vision, I'm just reporting the story, mm-hmm. because the story is true, and it is shocking. But if it was from God, Mike, if it was real, then when he declared, I'm putting it in a note, and I want you to wait a year, now he had the world's attention. Because if he had just stood up in his little synagogue and said, Jesus is Messiah, well, they would have carted him out the door and put him in a hospital. Said, yeah, you know, the man's lost his mind. He's gone crazy. He's 108. He's senile. And you and I would have never heard the story. The media would have shut it down. His own synagogue members would have never said it outside the walls of the synagogue. It would have all been shut down. But when he announces effectually to the world, I'm putting it in a note and wait a year, he had the world's attention, the religious world. And he also had their curiosity for a year. So when it was opened, then when it was decoded, and then when the media got a hold of it, Israel Today and News First Class, then it was on the internet, and then little videos were made about it, and then I was reporting on it, and then some years later I write a book on it, and then they make a movie about my book, and it goes all over the world. I mean, that was brilliant. Mm-hmm. That was brilliant. I mean, again, if he had just said it in a secret corner somewhere, it would have been buried, and you and I would never have heard of it. But by putting it in the note, I mean, if that came from God, that would be something just like God would say. I mean, we want this to go to the world. And so that's what happened. And so I think that's why. Now, there's also a Jewish tradition, Mike, that among certain denominations of Judaism, Judaism has its denominations just like Christian religions do, but in certain denominations of Judaism, there is a tradition that you can speak of a person and his life for up to 1 year after his death, and then after that year, you can then speak more fully of his work and his legacy and his, you know, his teachings or even controversial things. So that might also be why there was that 1 year stipulation, to kind of hold to that tradition of wait until I've been dead a year, because I know this is going to change my legacy. It's going to make a lot of you mad. So wait a year. That could also be why he did that.
Now, in this note, the note didn't reveal a last name for Jesus. So, Yeshua, Yehoshua, Jesus. If it doesn't say Jesus of Nazareth or mm-hmm. Jesus son of Joseph, how do we know it is Jesus Christ mm-hmm. to whom Rabbi Kaduri is referring?
Excellent question, and a very fair question, and I deal with this in great detail in my book. To be perfectly fair and perfectly honest about this, which I am in my book, and I will be here on this radio broadcast, what the revelation of the name, you're right, was simply Yehoshua. Now, that translates literally and directly into English as Joshua, but Christians know and Bible scholars know that the word Jesus is an invented word, and here's how it happened. It went from Yeshua, which is the short form of Yehoshua, and into the New Testament, which was written in Romanized Greek. The name that we wind up with in the Greek manuscripts is Iesus, I-E-S-U-S, Iesus. That's the Romanized Greek version of Yeshua. And then, of course, later when the English language got a hold of it, we took that I and gave it that hard J sound and took the I away and put the J in, and now we've got this word Jesus. And so, to this day, English-speaking people refer to Yeshua, the Christ, the Messiah, as Jesus. It's an invented word. But you know, we're dealing in English, so I'm translating it over to English. So, you're right. You know, it didn't say Jesus the Christ or Jesus of Nazareth. He didn't say Jesus of the New Testament. But here's what I'm saying. for years prior to his death, again, these students in his Jewish seminary, the yeshiva, were saying, look, he was teaching. Yeshua is the Christ. And he meant Yeshua of the New Testament. That's why some of us came to him as Lord and Savior. Well, not only that, but think of it. He told his people, I'm going to leave the name of the real Messiah. And he says, Yeshua. Well, some of the detractors have said, he just said Yeshua. That's a common name. That could be anybody. Yeah, but the problem is, of all the faith systems in the world, there's only one who calls its Messiah Yeshua. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm going to tell you the name of the real Messiah. It's Yeshua. So it's pretty apparent that was who he was referring to. He wasn't just referring to some nebulous Joshua out there. He said, I'm going to tell you the name of Messiah.
So on January 28th, 2006, Rabbi Yitzhak Kaduri dies.
Yes.
A year later, the note is revealed, and yes, the prophecy is revealed to the world. What was the Jewish reaction to that?
Shock. To this day, the Orthodox Jews still claim that it was some kind of a hoax, you know, that the note was a fake, a forgery, a trick. Of course, my response to that is, okay, then where's the real note? I mean, you know, somebody put it up there from his organization. They knew there was a note. They waited a year. It didn't appear 6 months later or 4 years later. It appeared 1 year later. Israeli media reported on it. The only time they didn't like it, Mike, was when they discovered, after they decoded it, that it said Yeshua. Then, all of a sudden, it became a trick, a hoax. And they completely and utterly destroyed the note. So there's no way to really, really forensically check it. But all I can tell you is the documented evidence is the note was on his website, posted by somebody in his organization, reported on by Israeli media sources, and it stayed there until it was decoded and until they realized that the name he had left was Messiah Yeshua.
And what was the reaction by the Christian community
that
revelation?
At first, there was quite an elation over the whole thing. But since then, and I've spent a lot of my time trying to educate Christians, you cannot think of the story in the Western Christian mindset. You've got to think of it in the totally Jewish rabbinical mindset. But eventually, Christians began to shy away from the story, saying, well, this couldn't be. God wouldn't appear to some Kabbalist, some mystic. Jesus wouldn't present himself to some rabbi that's into mysticism and divination. Well, wait a minute. God appeared to Paul, who was a murderer, on his way to kill Christians, on his way to destroy the Christian church. That doesn't even come close to Kaduri. Kaduri was a man of peace. He's like the Mother Teresa of Jews all of his life. Mm-hmm. But Paul was on his way to destroy Christians. By the way, Paul was a messianic rabbinical Jew, had some touches of Kabbalah in him. I can prove that from the New Testament scriptures. Which, by the way, Kabbalah, I don't condone Kabbalah, but I'm saying it's a very integral part, mystical part of Orthodox Judaism. So, you know, Western Christians just need to chill a little bit when they're reading this story, not get all worked up and demand what God could and couldn't do and would and wouldn't do. So some Christians are still very excited about the story, but others are looking at it kind of down the bridge of their nose saying, well, God wouldn't do that. Well, as a matter of fact, he's done it before, and it could be that he did it again in Yitzhak Kaduri. And it makes sense that he would, Mike, or that he could, because the most famous rabbi in all of modern Israel's history, who would reach millions, and if we are in the last days, and if Jesus is soon to appear, then why would God not one more time reveal to his people, the Jews, that Jesus is Messiah through their most venerated rabbi? He could, and it's possible that he did.
And in this prophecy, he also, or actually prior to the prophecy itself, because he said this when he was still alive, he said that the Messiah would not appear until after Ariel Sharon had died.
Right.
At the time, Ariel Sharon was alive and well.
That's right.
And as you said, he lapsed into a coma in early 2006. Well, Ariel Sharon subsequently died on January 11th, 2014.
Right.
So the Messiah didn't come back on January 12th.
Right.
We got to take a break, but when we get back, I want to ask you, where does this go from here?
Right.
I mean, we've got the backwards-looking
stuff. When's Messiah coming?
Yeah, we've got the backwards-looking
right.
stuff. Now let's look forward,
right.
which we'll do when Ask the Preacher continues. Welcome back to Ask the Preacher. I'm your host, Mike Bates. With me in the studio, Reverend Carl Gallops. So, Carl, we're talking about your book, The Rabbi Who Found Messiah, the story of Yitzhak Kaduri and his prophecies of the end time. And an integral part of this narrative is that in Rabbi Kaduri's prophecy, he said that the Messiah would not appear until after Ariel Sharon died.
Right.
Shortly thereafter, Ariel Sharon fell into a coma.
Right.
And he was in that coma how long?
8 years and 7 days.
8 years and 7 days in the coma. Ariel Sharon died on January 11th, 2014.
Correct.
Jesus didn't come back on January 12th.
Right.
So what's the timeline here?
Yeah. Well, thank you. Well, first let me say to the audience, let not your hearts be troubled. I am not setting dates and times. My book does not set dates and times. And actually, Rabbi Kaduri didn't set a date or a time. What he literally said was, Messiah would not appear before Sharon died. In other words, he would appear sometime after Sharon died. Now, when he said that, he could not have known that Sharon was going to be in an 8-year coma. So the whole world is, you know, sitting on edge watching for 8 years, and that it would arrive in 2014. Prior to him making those prophecies, Israeli media reported for several years that Kaduri was fond of proclaiming that he had a vision of Messiah. Messiah was soon to appear. Messiah was soon to come to Israel. And he was calling on Jews all over the world to return to Israel for the imminent coming of Messiah. So then later, when he attached this apparent time marker of Sharon's life and death to it, and then all the amazing things happened, Sharon goes into a coma, 8 years, 7 days, dies on a Sabbath, etc. All of that stuff happened. Then people understood the urgency of Kaduri's prophecies about the coming of the Messiah, and they attached to it. They said, well, apparently he meant Messiah's coming soon after Sharon dies. And I would say that, that would be my educated speculation too, that that's what Kaduri meant, that Messiah would come soon after Sharon dies. Now, what does soon mean? Is that days? Is that months? Is that years? Well, I think it's not 100 years. I think it's not 50 years. I think he meant soon. I think he meant maybe within our lifetime. But it's very important to remember that he did not say on a certain day after his death. What he literally said was, Messiah won't come before Sharon dies. Now think of this, Mike. The two startling statements he made, he nailed them both. He said the real Messiah, his name is Jesus. Well, you and I know the scriptures. He nailed that. He's a 100% accurate prophet there. The second thing he said was, and Messiah won't come before Ariel Sharon dies. And again, Ariel Sharon was alive, and he couldn't have known he'd be in a coma for 8 years. So he nailed that too, because Messiah didn't come while Ariel Sharon was alive. For all he knew, Sharon could have lived another 30 years. But he didn't. But he was right. He did not come before Sharon dies. Now Sharon has died. Now the time marker is gone. That's gone. So the message is, the apparent message is, Messiah could appear any day now. You know, I'm not setting dates and times. I'm just answering your question. And that's a very good question. People ask it all the time.
Well, and we've done Ask the Preacher episodes previously about prophecy and the end times. And I sort of look at this as, well, it's another piece that fits in
more,
the puzzle.
One more piece. I mean, again, you're right, Mike. It could be that this whole thing is a farce. You know, it could be. But the evidence seems to indicate that this really happened. The guy really said it. And again, I ask the question, what if this guy had a visitation from God? Wouldn't it be just like God in the last days to reveal to the most famous rabbi, to the Jews in the last days, that Jesus is Messiah? Yes, God would do something just like that, and maybe he did, and that's the purpose of me telling the story.
So if we are in the end times,
yeah,
what do we do? And by we, that means both we Christians, but also we non-Christians. What does humanity do now?
Yeah. Well, for Christians, especially for those that aren't Christians, you need to turn to the Lord. I mean, that's the message of the Bible. For those that are Christians, the Bible answered that in 2 Peter says, how should we then live? We should be holy, and we should be prepared for that day. And we should pray that we speed its coming. Why? Because that's when the end of man's wicked rule and reign ends and the beginning of the righteous rule and reign of Jesus Christ. We should be glad for it. We should hope for it. We should pray for it. In the meantime, we need to live lives that advance the kingdom of Jesus Christ.
All right. Well, I have a lot more questions about this book, I don't have more time to ask them, however.
I have a lot more answers, but I don't have time.
Well, the answers are in the book, so let me encourage people to buy the book. The title of the book, The Rabbi Who Found Messiah, The Story of Yitzhak Kaduri and His Prophecies of the End Time, written by Reverend Carl Gallups and published by WND Books. And there's also a DVD,
right? Well, it's a documentary movie, of history channel quality. Yeah, it's called The Rabbi Who Found Messiah, produced by award-winning film producer George Escobar.
And I have seen the DVD. I actually saw the DVD first, then I read the book, and the nice thing about the book is it went into far more detail than the DVD did. So the DVD was the appetizer, the book was the full meal.
Right, and let me say, churches all over America are showing the movie. I mean, it's a profound way for churches to get into the story.
So where can people buy the book and the DVD?
Anywhere good books are sold. Get on Amazon, get it at Barnes & Noble's, Books A Million, Lifeway, bookstores carry it. That's what you do. And go to my website, carlgallups.com.
Okay, you can also probably link to it from the church's website, right?
You sure can.
Which is www.hickoryhammockbaptist.org. Carl, we are completely out of time. Would you please close us in prayer?
I will. And Lord, we do pray for your soon return. According to your word, it is the day of joy and hope for those of us that know you. Lord, we don't know exactly what you did or did not speak to Yitzhak Kaduri, but it's exciting in these times to consider the possibility that you may have reached out in a profound way one more time to your people. And so, Lord, we pray that you'd help us to advance your kingdom as we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.